Humbled toilers of the sea. It's an area half the size of Switzerland, a jut of land carved from the oldest rock in the world. It's the Gaspé Peninsula, and it dominates the mouth of the St. Lawrence River. Here, a melting pot of cultures has carried on a way of life for over 400 years, dealing in a currency that's still very much in use today, Gaspé Cure. We'll tell you about that. We'll also catch a glimpse into the lives of a people whose living environment is among the most rugged and picturesque to be found anywhere. Come along. It's a quarter to four on a July morning. Courtney Simon is making his way out to the fishing grounds, a distance of about 3 kilometers off the Gaspé coast. This is the start of a typical day in cod season, retrieving nets set the day before. Making a living from the sea has been Courtney's life, just as it was for generations before him. The Gulf of St. Lawrence at this point is really an ocean, believed to have carried the Vikings, the first non-natives to witness the beauty of the peninsula. Strung along this coastline, like beads on a rosary, are toy-like villages, which paint a picture of the fragile yet harmonic balance of man, mountains, and sea. 250 kilometers long, the peninsula is dramatic and expansive, a backdrop to the lives of its people. Tucked into what is claimed to be one of the best natural harbors in the world is the city of Gaspé. Historically, very few ships bound from Europe to Canada in the days of canvas sail passed Gaspé Basin without dropping anchor in the haven to replenish supplies before continuing their journey to the interior. The setting and climate, along with prolific salmon-breeding rivers, the York and Dartmouth, which feed into the bay, have attracted summer visitors for over a century. The day-to-day pace of the center contrasts to life in the surrounding villages, a place where street names spell the early story. Today, Gaspé houses the offices of a regional municipality that was formed in recent years, amalgamating a vast territory, 20,500 square kilometers, which includes 8 regional municipalities. The total population of the area is about 150,000. The study of the Gaspé and its story is an ongoing labor of love for historian Jules Bélanger.
When Jacques Cartier came in Gaspé, the discoverer, they were around 600, 700 maybe, Iroquois. And they were not very glad to see the French coming here with their peculiar aspects, and they did not know very much what they were to do. But history says that Jacques Cartier convinced them that it was a good thing. Even so that he brought back to France two of these Amerindians. The Mi'kmaq used to say Gaspeg, and it means the end of the world. I think it's well found, because we're not at the end of the world, but for years, the Gaspé was isolated. The highway to go around the Gaspé, it was open for the first time in 1930. The communication with the center of the country, with Quebec and Montreal, it was by boat, because otherwise it would be through the woods, and it's a long way. It was hard to live here as fishermen or as farmers. Life was hard, and they could not build houses for centuries. Since they were not very rich, they would build very often temporarily. So, after two or three generations, they would have to change to rebuild the house. That's why we don't have so many old houses. But nowadays, people of the Gaspé are proud of their little houses, their little village, clutch on the sides of the mountains. It's like people who want it not to be too cold. They just get together in the bottom of the little cone. See, you're protected from the sea and protected from the wind, from the forest. See, it's still there. We could see in the way they build their little village the influence of their tough life.
The Gaspé's young characteristics are very much reflected in its people. One whose life's experience is firmly entrenched here, and who now blends tradition with the contemporary, is Denise Lebrun.
I was born in this house and always lived in it. My father got it from his father, and today I own it. People could not phone to ask if they might bring a horse or wagon to the blacksmith. They would simply show up, and sometimes my father would say, "I cannot do that right now. I have already somebody waiting." If somebody who came from a place like Cloridorme down the coast, he could not go home the same day. My father would say, "So, Jeanne is in the house. If there is enough for 12, there is enough for 13. It's like this today with my bed and breakfast.
The Chic-Chocs and Notre Dame Mountains dominate the interior, rising 1,300 meters. Marking the coast are two of the most important landmarks of North American navigation, the tallest lighthouse in Canada at Cap de Roger, and this old light at the tip are nowadays identified with a major national park, Maxime Saint Amour.
The bedrock here tells this story about how this part of the planet was formed and when it was formed. Forillon National Park is located right at the tip of the Gaspé Peninsula, and it's important geographically because it's also the end of the long Appalachian chain. The history of that mountain chain dates way back before the Atlantic Ocean existed, and this part of the mountain chains was uplifted out of an ancient sea long before the American part of the mountain chain. So this rocky headland here, the rocks in Forillon, are about 175 million years older than the American part of this chain.
As well as the geology, the park interprets the many varieties of marine species, indigenous to about 4 square kilometers of ocean floor within the park's boundaries. The waters of the Gulf and their natural bounties have contributed to the origins and development of this jut of land.
Those Europeans coming here, they were interested in fish, but also in the furs. So they would exchange with the Indians. But the biggest interest of those Europeans coming here was fish, codfish. It's a real good place for codfish.
And so it was that cod, climate, and human endurance would support an economic base which remains intact to this day. Few regions of Canada can lay claim to having maintained unbroken trade links with European markets spanning centuries. An osprey fetches his midday meal. Meanwhile, offshore, Courtney and his crew head home. On this particular day, rough seas have resulted in a disappointing catch. The men drop their nets, and we'll have to await the next morning to see what rewards it may bring. Such is the dependence on the whims of nature. This vulnerability is something which has forever governed the lives of the Gaspé people. Woven into this fragile existence and compounding it was a system of doing business which took on greater significance in the era following the deciding battle on the Plains of Abraham. The social and economic patterns took on a different shape after the British conquest. Men from the Jersey Islands saw gold in the cod that was caught and dried along the coastline here. And for the next almost 2 centuries, the economy pivoted on stores like this one, William Hyman and Son. The deal here was that very little cash changed hands. The merchant would decide the value of the fisherman's catch, and payment would be made in credit at the company store. The enterprises of Frewing, Le Boutelier, and Hyman, all apprentices under taskmaster Charles Robin, came to dominate Gaspé life. André Lepage.
The impact of the company on the community was very important at many levels. There was not only a development on the market, but there was also a pyramidal system construct where the company was at the top and many small companies became mere middlemen or intermediaries between the company and the dairy producers. So that society was not homogeneous. It was a society very stratified, but that stratification was unstable, as everything depended upon the credit relation and the fortune of bad and good seasons.
Ironic that it was religion that whetted the appetite for the harvest from the sea. Evolving from the period of the Reformation, Roman Catholics' days of fasting did permit the eating of fish. As markets burgeoned in countries like Spain, France, and Italy, Gaspé cod suppliers profited. Through the credit system, though, most fishermen were kept in bondage throughout the 1700s and 1800s, until finally, the independent fishing cooperative was born. They came either to make a living, or as fate would have it, as survivors of the numerous coastal shipwrecks. Throughout the region, patterns of settlement are clearly evident today.
If we open the telephone book of the Gaspé, I could tell you at what village of the Gaspé you opened. For instance, if you open the book and if you say, I see some Packwood and Dunn and Reader, I would say that's Cap-des-Rosiers, because I know they're there. If you open the book at the Leblanc Landry, well, you'd be around Carleton Maria, where the Acadians came. Of course, if you open the book and if you tell me I have some Fitzpatrick, Aske, well, I'm going to tell you, you're probably around Gaspé. See, history is still very well marked in that book.
Cod fishing has not changed in any of its essentials since Basque, Norman, and Channel Islanders first spread their catches to dry. Heading, cleaning, splitting, salting, and drying in the plentiful days of sunshine and sea breezes traditionally gave the schooners that left the coast here an edge in getting their product to market. Stamped on the barrels, the words Gaspé cured became internationally known. Back at the beginning, as many as 500 ships carrying provisions for 6 months and a cargo of salt for curing crossed from France to the cod fisheries. Taking about a month to cure, white fish was and still is the term to describe a properly dried cod. Trade, especially with Portugal and Italy, continues to thrive. To await supplies aboard returning schooners meant having to make do, looking after oneself and your neighbor. This trait of fierce independence still characterizes the people today.
Tous les gens ici du village étaient, comme on peut dire, autonomes.
People in the village needed to be self-sufficient. They grew their own vegetables. Then there was the farm to be looked after, the animals, horses, pigs, cows. So they would produce their own milk, butter, eggs, meat, everything. Fishing was very important for our parents.
Ma mère était une femme d'extérieur. Elle travaillait beaucoup. Je suis d'une famille de 17 enfants.
My mother was an outdoor person. She worked very hard. Our family had 17 children. I was the 12th.
Les souvenirs que j'ai de ma mère, c'est une femme parce que j'avais de mes sœurs qui s'occupaient de la maison, qui était.
It was my sisters who tended to the house duties, sewing, cooking. My mother would assign them those jobs so she could work with my father.
On était 11 filles dans la famille, puis elle aidait à mon père, elle accompagnait, elle a toujours été très très proche.
She was very close to him. If rain threatened, she would go turn the fish.
Puis le soleil revenait, elle tournait sur l'autre sens. C'est toujours comme ça parce que.
Drying fish was a tough job.
I moved out here in 1970, and this was a true heaven for me, I guess, because although you're far from the city and all the different things you can find in the city, when one is very in tune with nature, he finds everything he needs in an area like this.
Here, where the old rock withstands the sea, the impact on the senses is overwhelming. Maxim knows this turf, his backyard, like no other. And seldom does he tire of introducing newcomers to his world.
The sea cliffs in Forillon shelter about 25,000 seabirds. And these populations are easy to see because they're right there in the sea, in the cliffs, nesting on narrow ledges depending on the species of birds, because we have double-crested cormorants, we have black-legged kittiwakes, herring gulls, black-backed gulls. And we also have the visits of gannets that nest right in Bonaventure Island, about 15 miles away. And there's about 110 species of fish, And of course, whales and seals. So I guess this is a naturalist dream to be able to live here, because it's an area where nature is so generous that you have this this awe all the time.
When I was a young boy, I remember having heard the tourists saying, we went around the Gaspé and it was wonderful. And we were kids and we were laughing a little at them, finding that they were kind of awkward. So what they had seen, sea and mountains, and they were saying that it was so wonderful. We did not understand them. It's only after years, when I went abroad, I went in other countries, I decided that those people that I used to laugh at, they were right. I laughed at them because I was ignorant. I did not know that we live in a wonderful country. I think, really, that I did not see another country so nice. In summer, in winter, it's a wonderful country to see. So I have to conclude that the men and women who can live here are lucky.
The day draws near. At dawn tomorrow, unchanged, the rhythm of life will be. For those who dwell upon Land's End, these toilers of the sea.
Place I know, it'll always be home.